So, yeah, thank you for the warm welcome, but first of all, I'm not talking about Berlin stuff, right? So I'm just gonna undress. Nein. So, that one. Don't worry, I'm not gonna go further, right? So, just making the assumptions. Also, I should probably go to the next slide because I am here also to talk about my box shit or bullshit. But I'm not done yet. So, Matthias, can you give me the other thing?
Yes, of course.
So, anybody, any idea where I'm going with this? Because I don't either. And the last thing I need is my little parrot, right? So, I'm here to talk about R. So the idea there was that Matthias asked me, like, hey, can you make a talk? And I said, well, sure, I can make a talk. So then I thought, okay, it's something in Hamburg, right? So Hamburg ships kind of work, right? So what does a person on a ship do? If they are evil, they are pirates, right? And what do pirates do? They say R. Okay, maybe somebody knows already where I'm going with this. Maybe I lost you already, but I will talk about the Google AR core demo and what you can do with it. So if you pay close attention, you might also get some extra prizes afterwards. So anything I missed? Yeah, so if we just go back to this slide, if you want to follow up, it's on bit.ly. Pirate minus AR minus slides, you'll find the slides for this talk. And if you wanted to tweet about it, it's not DevFestHH, it's Pirate AR. Thank you. also, in case you're wondering, I'm going so deep with this one that I'm even having scurvy right now, just to be the real pirate. So I'm not sick or anything, I'm just playing, okay? Scurvy is scorbut, which I also had to lock up before. So just in case you're wondering why I'm sounding sick, I'm not sick. Not at all. Sorry, it's a long-winded talk. Let's just dive into it, right? Core scurvy dog. One more time. It's going to come over. If you're getting annoyed by this already, just stay in. It's going to get worse. Some months ago, Google announced the AR kit. No, sorry, it's AR core. Sorry. wrong mistake there, which is essentially their initiative to make it easy for you to use an AR app without the funny hats I'm wearing. This is an Android lab, a library which you can use to create an Android application which helps you creating augmented reality. Augmented reality, short way to say it is R. What it uses is actually like a mixture between computer vision, which is like I take a look through the camera and try to understand what am I seeing on the camera, right? So it tries to find planes, horizontal planes, and maps them into a 3D world, where you can then use something like OpenGL or further things to render things on top. Surprisingly enough, it is super stable. So like, after this talk, I will, like, if you just come to me, I can show you the current AR apps and show you that, like, if the lighting conditions are right, it's like really, really stable. One thing about the stability, since it's not just computer vision based, but also it uses, by the way, Matthias, can I have a timer? Thank you. But it also uses sensors. It doesn't work that well in trains. Please don't ask me how I found out that, like, programming AR in a train is not the best idea. It also uses like the velocity sensors, and if you try to do this while the train is accelerating, your planes will move towards you. So best is to do it in a stable environment. Also another nice thing, which I will hopefully show you in a second or make it obvious for you in a second, is that AR Core allows you to color or change the lighting of the objects you are showing based on the real scene. So if the real scene is darker, your objects will appear darker. If the real scene is lighter, obviously your real objects will be lighter. The demo app I'm mostly talking about for now is essentially just creating a plane. So like this is an image from taken, it's actually a screenshot from the demo. And what we were seeing here is like the white things are not actually in my hotel room, just saying. This is the plane, which is an augmented reality plane. So this is like a surface in virtuality, which AR Core decided should be placed there. How does AR Core know that this is a plane or that there could be a plane in reality? I don't know, like I think you guys in the front rows can see that sometimes here are like green dots. And those green dots are so-called feature points. This is a point the camera and therefore AR Core can identify wherever you are. So like if you move a bit to the side, the point will move relatively to the side too. So best thing for those feature points are corners. So, or things where a lot of contrast is happening, like the texture, so to say, is really high. So you can see like, okay, this one will always be the same because like here's a little green dot and if I move a bit to the side, it will then also know through the difference in my movement and the velocity based on the phone. I was just like making the phone feel, so to say, it will also feel where it should be in 3D space. So through this indirection, it can find out that this 3D dot, or this feature point is further back than, let's say, this one, which is super important if you want to go from like the real reality to the augmented reality. So because it uses this dot and then the depth information of this dot and maybe a dot over there, it can find out where a plane should be. For everybody who is good in math, 3 points are normally enough to find out where a plane is in 3D space. But we have a lot more points here because we don't know how our surface will look like, so we need more points and then fit a plane onto it. Okay, so now we have a plane. What do we do with a plane? Obviously, we put Androids on top, because why not, right? So what happens in the demo app is I click somewhere on the surface of the phone, and where I clicked, it finds out where I clicked on the plane in 3D, and then puts a so-called anchor point there. And then based on this anchor point, I can like add another like 3D object on top. And in this case, it will only be an Android, because this is how the demo app was written. Yeah, and I can do this like up to 16 times, so I can have up to 16 Androids in this demo. So far, so clear? Okay, then I take the time just to drink some more, I'm sorry. Just imagine this was the waves on the ship we are all running through and we are all pirates, like something along those lines, use your creativity. Okay, so the, like this is what the demo does, but also there's another thing, like take a look at the lightness of those Androids. So this one hopefully looks a bit darker. Like, I don't know, I'm doing the thing you shouldn't do, I'm just swapping background more. Like, this is a bright one because like the surface, like surrounding it is rather bright. But here you see like a big blob of shadow over there. So that's why this Android also gets darker. Which sounds simple, but like in computer graphics, the simple things sometimes are the important things, which will make you sure that like the thing you are seeing is real or not. So like if shadow is, for instance, missing, you immediately notice. If this thing is too bright, you will see, okay, like, yeah, this doesn't work this way, so I have to work on this one some more. So that's why I really like this demo sample, because it shows you like, okay, it just works out of the box and it makes you help, and it helps you to be more real. And one more. So yeah, this is little Andy. And this is also therefore the end of the demo app. At least the parts on the surface, right? So let's dive deeper, because like we are probably interested in how does the demo work and like the nitty gritty details. So let's go to this the hunt for code. Let's find the treasures in the. Okay, I'm sorry. this is how the code package looks like. So I was skipping some parts, like the assets, for instance. But you see, okay, like the hierarchy of the packages makes sense. And what I also found super interesting is that it has a package info.java in it. So like this is if you want to have a documentation on the package level, this one will give you the documentation for it. So sorry, that was for me the first time that I'm seeing this one and I was rather confused, but it kind of makes sense if you create automated documentation from it, which this app doesn't. But then again, it's good to know what it's there for. So also inside we see that there's a general split happening, right? So we have the Android Hello AR activity here, which probably does like good things with like the UI and everything. Then we have a camera permission helper, which probably also makes sense if you want to like access the camera because you're doing an AR app. It makes sense to like actually extract it into one class and use it. Also, what I was really happy to see is that there's a rendering down here. So that like somebody thought about this that we should split it up into like we have a background renderer, we have like the object renderer and some more things over there. So far it looks rather nice, right? So the things I didn't show yet is also there is a lips folder on the demo sample. So this lips folder contains exactly one library, which is the OBJ library. For the ones unknown, OBJ is the default format which is used for this app to render 3D objects. So it's a file format which saves vertices like the corner points of an object and then have faces on top of the corner points and then have normals and textures. So like most of the, or I won't even say all, of the 3D modeling apps can create an OBJ file format. This library they used can then read it, right? So they read this file in and then create it into a format which OpenGL, so like what AR Core uses to render 3D things on the surface, it's called OpenGL, can use to render 3D objects. The thing I found curious is like this is directly the library. So somebody put the jar there, even though there is like an MVN or a Gradle coordinate existing. So like why not use the indirect dependency instead of the library file when there are no changes? So for me, it just felt like bloat and I don't know. It was kind of strange to see. Then let's go to the Hello AR activity. I didn't had like a great time reading through this one because this activity has like 300 lines of code and alone 120 go into the onDraw method. So this onDraw method, sorry, it's intentionally that you don't read it, so don't squint too much. It's just like there's a lot of code and a lot of stuff happening inside this onDraw. OnDraw is called by the Java OpenGL, the Android OpenGL system to make sure that it renders a frame at a specific time. So here it runs through like, I don't know, it obviously starts with a big try block and ends with the end of the try block because we all know what's happening inside, so we just don't need to care for like differences in what breaks when and how. So. And then like it starts. So it makes sure that from the AR core it gets the current frame. So like R, it gets the like current understanding of the AR core to what the current world is like. From this one, it creates the It also creates the model view matrix from this one, so that I know okay when I now want to render a 3D object. I have to take this AR core frame and like modify my current matrix with this one so that I know where the objects will end up in space. What it also does is it runs through the tabs. So every time when I draw, it checks like, hey, is there a new tab happening? So should I create a new object? And if I create a new object, blah, 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 blah. Right? So for me, this is functionality which shouldn't be in the onDraw. This should be handled like somewhere else. So like just saying there, yeah, it feels rather interesting. Also what I found super interesting is like member variables are called M, like M session for instance, or also sometimes they're called M underscore session, which is like not so common in Java, right? So just like one more insight from this demo. So like I said, this onDraw does a lot of things, and it does them all with a catch throwable in the end. I'm not entirely sure. what other things did I found? Right now it can only draw Androids. So in case I want to draw, like, I don't know, my favorite action figures, because like I don't want to carry them with me, I want to have them in my AR app, because who doesn't want to take their AR app on a go and make pictures of your AR figure? Okay, anyway, it's probably just me. I couldn't use this one. So what I could do is like replace the Andy, which is like the Android 3D object, with another one, but not with two other ones or something. It's rather limited. But what it does is it also loads the assets. Like an asset is in this case, like it can be the texture, like how does this thing look like except for the 3D coordinates. It loads the shaders, which means like, okay, how does this object behave in 3D space, so to say, like where does it get rendered, when does it get rendered, and how do the texture map to the original object together with some other things. And this is actually the texture I was talking about. So like those things are stored in the resources. So like in the APK somewhere. And yeah, if you want to extend it, you would probably do something which I will tell you now about. So obviously I didn't do the right thing. So those are two tofus, which you will probably hate me for, right? So like this is an emoji. I don't know. I think it was like a beach or something. And sorry that the rendering of the Mac doesn't do it. On my Android device, it works perfectly. So just saying, if you want to see the slides, look at them on an Android device. I took a look at the Android, at the demo app from AR. And thought like, okay, what is the thing I want to do with it, right? So like, this is a nice starting point, but there are some things I didn't like. Like I didn't like the onDraw method, which is like just too big for me to understand. It's not extendable, and it does too many things. So what I did is I forked it. So it's on GitHub, so I can just like take it and hope that I don't know, nobody will complain about that I did this. If you want to follow up on this one, it's like obviously QR codes. I think QR codes are the new big thing. So if you want to scan this in, this is the time. Or if you can remember my name and Pirate AR, then this would be the GitHub repository. So everything I'm discussing there right now here is also then will be finding there. You will be able to find there, sorry. Okay, so what did I do? I tried to make it more understandable. Like, if you read through the code, my goal was that like somebody might be able to understand it without reading through all of the dependency and finding out what's going on there. Also, specifically, I have a nicer icon. So like, I created this icon by my own hands, as you can tell by the sheer programmer art on it. Also what I didn't like, if you want to test it out, you can just like go to the GitHub repository and install the APK found in there. For the AR demo from Google, you actually had to like build the app one more time in order to try it out. And there's one step missing here. You need to install an APK first. So like there's a dependent APK which you need to have installed before you install this one, which will come with the AR core. Okay, so let's also go here quickly through a description on what I did. So this is a screenshot of the app, and you can tell that this one uses four new buttons. Those buttons will now actually change what will be displayed, or what object I will be adding. Will I add a bird, like this one who is already falling asleep? I hope nobody from you is like feeling like this one right now. If so, I'm sorry. Also, I'll add Connor Contentful. I will talk about him some more time. And it will add the ND just because. This one is also super interesting, which I will come into in two slides. So you hit one of the buttons, and then you can say, like, hey, my favorite objects are there, right? So like, this is Connor Contentful. Don't ask me why it's called Contentful. This is the bird, which is this one, but just I tried to 3D model it, I think. So it's not as nice as this one. And this is Andy. Also, this was one of the few attempts which I had trying to AR while driving a train. If the train is in the station, it works. But So So either he wanted to bottom feed or I'm getting too boring. What do you think? Yes. Yes is also a good one, and I take the first one. Thanks. Ah, it's even the glue didn't work anymore. It's probably just getting too hot for him. So I leave you there. Don't fly away yet. So just imagine I have a big parrot over here. What's the next thing? So I also added one functionality, which I found super important too. So this is, again, you see the red grid here, which is red because the tracking was not 100%. So like he thinks for 80% of the cases, this will be a plane. That's why it's red. If it's white, it says like, yeah, roughly 100%, this is a plane. But what you are hopefully seeing here is that I also added Android XML layout files. So I can render an XML layout file on the AR kit. So you're seeing an image view here, you're seeing a text view over there, you see buttons over there, and you see like some random rating bar. Which is like, if you've done something with 3D rendering before, also if you followed the Flutter talk before, text is really hard. Sorry. Scoreboot and everything. So the text is hard because like you have something like text which goes below one and goes up, then you have emojis. Emojis are a completely different story by itself, and I didn't want to re-implement it. So I was rather looking for how can I actually create something that I don't have to care for this one. So in this case, it is like I'm creating an XML layout for Android using the tools I know. And then render it into a texture. What are the changes I added? Before we had the Hello AR activity, which did a lot of things, I want to say even everything. It did the rendering part, it did the touch behavior and stuff, and I didn't like that, right? What I did here is like I created a new class which is called Scene. This one will contain all of the objects to be rendered and renders all of the objects. And then the only thing I have to do inside the main activity is like if I touch somewhere something, then I tell the scene like, hey, this guy just touched on this object, this is the position, just render an object there without the AR activity know how to render something. And everything it does is essentially just related to the UI. Also, no more like weird try catches, but. Like I said, like the scene also does take care of the actual combination to the AR core. So like it will take care of like okay, what's the current estimation of the world the app is seeing, and this one does the scene and not the AR activity, which. Didn't reduce too much of the lines of code, but at least it reduced a lot of the complexity by adding new functionalities. So like the button clicks and the ability to load different objects. I also introduced the renderer functionality. So like abstracting a bit more from the object renderer, I created a renderer which is just able to render something on the screen. What the renderer is now also doing for the objects is they are able to read them from the external DIR, like the external directory, like not the APK anymore, but read it just from another place where everything or even other parts of the app have access to. So let's say you have a content management system or a content infrastructure, and this one contains your 3D objects. So the things it needs to do is now just load the 3D objects into the external directory and makes it immediately accessible to your AR app, again, which was not possible before. Also taking care of the textures, the shaders, and everything is done by the renderer. And like I said, you can also create classes on top of this one which take care of another objects like the XML layouts I was talking so much about before. And if there are any questions, just interrupt me. If I'm too slow, let me know. If I'm too fast, don't let me know. Okay. How does this work in the code? I already said that I'm directly rendering from a layout, right? So internally, it uses the object renderer, extends it, and replaces one method, which is like how does the texture got read. So the retexture in the object renderer just takes the name of the object and replaces the object, like the .obj file extensions, with a PNG, and then loads this texture from the external DIR. But since we now want to load the layout XML, we have to somehow create another bitmap, which will then be used as our texture. And if I'm just bloating this code of you, this is how this works. So the base functionality there is that I use a canvas. Canvas, which uses a bitmap, and then the bitmap is the thing I want to create. So I have somehow, somewhere defined the width and the heights of the texture. Like, this is dependent on your use case. So like normally it would be like the screen size if you just want to render like a screen layout and then make it move away or something. Or if you want to use it for like, I don't know, a sign or something, then you would consider the size and pixel of the sign. So yeah, I take this one and say, give me just the measure spec for the view so that I can inflate a view and set its measure, like, and tell it to measure exactly the size I was giving it to. Otherwise you will get a view which is of size zero and the texture is probably not what you want. So like those two lines of code make sure that the size of the view will be the size you gave it to. And then after you measured it, you lay it out with the given size, and lastly you draw it into a canvas. And then what the canvas does, it draws it into the bitmap, and I can use the bitmap as a texture. So for me, for text rendering, this was like super important, and I am a bit too fast right now, but because right now I would go to the summary part already, and again, I'm sorry for the tofu. Not that I don't like tofu, but in this case, there it wouldn't taste so much. I mean, I don't know, but I guess that this one doesn't taste. Anyway, sorry. So let me summarize on what just happened. I was taking a look at the Google AR demo, which can be found under this GitHub link, and I was super happy that I can place Androids anywhere, right? The thing is, then I took a closer look at it and thought, like, that's... like for reading of the source code, this is probably not the best I want to read. So I thought, like, maybe I can do something better. So I started the Pirate AR demo, which can be found over there again. And there I added the functionality of adding like random objects to be rendered, and also the ability to render text and layouts into the AR world. And if you want to read more about Unity AR, and also if you want to find out, like, is there another like language or something I can use? The current abilities are, you can use Java, which is what I did, which uses OpenGL in the end, which if you are unfamiliar with it, might be a bit cumbersome for you. So what I would recommend for somebody who starts with it, maybe taking a look at the Unity support there. Because with Unity, you can just create 3D scenes without necessarily needing to know all of the details, but at least you can get something running really quick. Same goes for Unreal, which is like, sorry, I have never used Unreal, but I'm assuming it's similar to Unity. But I think it uses C or C++, but again, I don't really know Unreal. But at least there's, like, if you follow this link on my slides, there's a description how you would use the Unreal IDE to make an AR running. Also, there is a web way of doing things, which I have even less of an idea how this works, but Google talks about this quite a lot, and I yet have to find out how I can do something with this. Okay, so thank you.
How long did it take you in order to go and extend the demo app?
So how long does it did it take me to extend the demo app?
Like a few days or weeks?
I don't know. It did not take me years. It was like more finding out a good abstraction layer of the current demo app, like finding the right ways to cut it. It was not weeks, and it was also not like it was done in 3 hours. So it was probably days, but I don't know. I haven't measured it. Also, like, I have work to do, so it's like not that I can just do this all the time. If you want some kind of measurement, like on the GitHub repository, you find the commit history. and then can probably measure how much time it was. But
okay, cool, thanks.
I'm not going to throw the bird, so I need some runner. Matthias? No, I'm bad at throwing, as you could tell. So this one over there, the one who's drinking and flirting with you. Ooh. The one next to Nick, then.
Can I ask?
Yes.
Okay, so a few years ago, I was playing with Vuforia, maybe you know. Mm-hmm. So the library was built in the C++, and you were writing the whole drawing method in the C++. So did you notice any performance issue on this R core? Because it's draws in Java, maybe it's called from the native as well. Did you? Do you know how it's happening in the behind?
So, I don't know how I can do this, but if I have a mouse cursor somewhere, we can go back to the monster slide, right? Which was hopefully here. No. Sorry. So, this one, right? So, as you can tell, somewhere it says GL dot. Okay, there is a Java binding for OpenGL which just redirects us to native calls. And for me, it's fast enough. Then again, I haven't used it in, I don't know, a lot of sparkling apps or something. So I have to say I'm not sure if there's an overhead in using the Java parts versus doing it natively. The sad thing is I don't think you can do it natively because those libraries are only on Java. So... Matthias?
Thanks.
He doesn't listen to me anymore.
Yeah, he needs to bring two anyways.
Thank you. This one.
Yeah, I also want to ask a question.
You have the next question. Wait, Matthias.
Yes, you can bring two.
I'm assuming it's going to be a good question. It's still there some.
Yeah.
You know, we pirates share. Arr.
So I'm interested in this lighting system that you described. So it's somehow calculated how bright the scene is, right?
Yes.
Do the objects themselves also pass shadows from one to another? So if I have a really big object in front of another, does it know from where the light comes and puts shadows on top of the other, so they ignore each other? Or
yes.
You would need to build this on your own?
You have to build it on your own. So it has nothing to do with shadow. Everything it does is just multiplying the color by a value.
Ah, okay, but then it doesn't know from where the light is coming.
Yeah, exactly. Oh,
okay.
It just knows, and generally it's this bright, so the ambient color should probably be this one, and then makes it darker or brighter.
Okay, thanks.
Oh, you don't get a second one, I'm sorry. Just saying, managing expectations.
Thank you. So it's just an obvious question coming. Right after this one is so are the lightnings that you have seen on the Andy, are they embedded in the texture?
No.
It had some lightning, yeah? So there was a direction of the light somehow.
Yeah.
And it was somehow rendered, so the question is, where is it placed in the scene?
This comes from the fragment shader. The fragment shader does the lightning condition and calculations.
Okay, can it be set up somehow in the beginning? So
yeah, so depending on which one you take, if you take the demo sample, you would just replace the text file, which is called ND fragment, I think, with whatever lightning conditions you want to, or lightning calculations you want to use.
Oh, okay, good. Thank you.
You're welcome. So I'm just saying I still have birds, right? And if the bird is the word, then, you know, talk to me. Yay!
Well, that works. That's a good strategy for...
Isn't it? Hey.
So I have a question regarding these buttons that you basically created bitmap and just rendered that bitmap. How would you approach if I would like to be able to rotate it? I mean, with rotation of phone, I would like that these buttons stay on, for example, on the screen, and with rotation of phone, they are rotated.
Yeah, this would be a technique called billboarding, and it's essentially how you set up your the other one, the vertex shader. So the vertex shader is okay, you have a matrix which takes every corner point multiplies it by something and then has the real representation on the 2D screen. You just have to make sure that this one takes care that it's always rotated the same way to the screen.
So you mean you create this bitmap and afterwards you rotate just bitmap?
Yeah, yeah. That is another way of saying it, you're right. So should we try this?
Okay, and I have another question. You said you tried it out on a train and had trouble because your elements move towards you. Is there somehow this kit built to be on the go as well? Can you use some kind of coordinate system that, like, I don't know, you're walking along a street and then there's AR objects that you pass along? Or is it just all own calculation manual stuff?
So that's a good question, actually. So right now, I cannot have something like... You don't get two birds, though, just saying. So you cannot have something like a scene registration. So like you would need to let the app know, okay, this is the place where something specific happens. What the app does, it just finds planes. It doesn't know anything about registration or something off the surface. Does it make sense, or should I try another way? So, like, if you want to do something like this, you would need to add functionality and, like, okay, finding out, okay, what is this object? Is this object what I want it to be? And if it's, like, the one marker I have, like, I don't know, I want it every trash can to let an object appear, whatever. I'm in Hamburg, so I'm thinking about trash cans. So then you would need to add it yourself. The AR core doesn't offer it.
Okay, thank you. Cool.
You're welcome.
Any more questions?
Yes, you don't get a second one.
So, question, as Vuforia was mentioned here, so basically with Vuforia, you can also teach and take some parts of your predefined image in order to place your object in specific. Yeah. Not just by tapping, but for example, if I always want to replace Apple logo on my laptop.
Yeah.
So is it possible with Google's?
The answer, no. Like, what you can do is, like, whenever I find a plane or like a plane in the space, I want to put something on top. But finding like a specific logo and replacing it, that's not what AR Core is right now for. Thanks. Yay, one more over there. Matthias. Minions, you know.
So my question is about how well is interaction supported with the objects in the 3D world? For example, you have added the functionality that you can render an XML file there.
Yeah.
So I'm pretty sure, because it's just a bitmap, that click handler and such stuff in the XML wouldn't work. But do I get the position of the object back from the AR core so that I can compute where the user tapped on the object such that I can use buttons or whatever that I put there?
So part of the question was, do I get the object position back, right?
Yeah. And so tap position, when I tap somewhere.
So what you get is, like, you only get the 2D position of the tap on the phone, right? And then from there, you have to shoot a beam in the direction of the current facing camera position and then hope that through running all of the surfaces, you find the one. The answer is, you have to do it yourself.
Okay.
So, like, you have your objects in OpenGL somehow rendered, and then you use default game engine methods to find out where you actually clicked on the surface. There's, as far as I know, nothing that helps you from AR Core.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah, thank you. Sorry. I think you're burning. It's number 3 today already. No, it's great.
Hold on, you need the microphone.
Okay. There must be order. Yeah, it was cool.
This point cloud that you can update, is the point cloud is it the vertices that you can see, or with other words, can I access the set of feature points somehow?
Yes. That is exactly the point cloud. If you see the dots here, this is part of the point cloud, and every feature point is inside there.
Okay, so I can build my own logic on top. So I can use them to, for example, I have an object on a table and I move around it. Maybe I can use them to generate a mesh myself from the object. Maybe.
So yes, you can use them yourself, but they are not as dense. They are not as, like, as you can tell, like, this is an open door, and you have, like, three dots on it. So it's hard to extrapolate that this is a door.
Yeah, well, it's shadow to total. I need this. Yeah. I need features at all, but so I can access it, and they are provided from cycle to cycle. So I can really... Yeah. Okay, that was the question. Thank you.
You're welcome. Anyone with more questions? Over there, behind the counter, the column.
So what are you rendering onto? Do you have like a surface view and you can include it in any layout you want?
Yes.
Oh.
Thank you. That was your easy question, right? let's try this. It can't fly, you know? I mean, now any less, but. Hi.
Hello again. This will be a really simple question, but I didn't check the AR core lately, so I just know that it's kind of limited to device, so the Google Pixels and some Samsungs. Do you know why is the reasoning behind?
Behind you is an answer, but I mean the obvious one would be that you need high-end hardware, right? So like you need a fast camera and you need a fast processing cycle and they want to sell hardware, but you had an answer.
The answer is that AR Core is based on Google Tango, and there are some sensors required, and currently they are in the S8 and S8 Plus and Pixel 2, but not on the other phones. There is a hack which allows to run AR Core on other devices, but it doesn't work too well.
That's great to know, thanks. You get your bird afterwards.
Any more questions?
Awesome. Then thank you again. And if there are more questions, I will be around today and tomorrow. Thank you.